Welcome. Today, we are going to delve into our next school of thought, TCM doctrine of Hejian Xuepai. Hejian doctrine, and from this point onward, we will be looking at more, shall we call, contemporary doctrines. Again, this is one of the class in the whole course of overview of TCM classics and doctrines. Medical classics, Taoist medicine classics and doctrine, formulary doctrines and Shanghan doctrines. These are initiated what we consider as classical doctrines. While the doctrines that were developed during the Song Dynasty onward, including the one we are going to be discussing today, are considered contemporary doctrines. They are Hejian doctrine that dwell mostly with fire-heat pathology. There are Yisui doctrine that dwell more on Zhanghu differentiations. There are Gongxie doctrine that focuses on attacking the pathogens. There is Dangxi doctrine that deal with excessive yang and deficient yin situations. And there are also Mingmen doctrine that deal with gate of life concepts. And not at least the Wenbin doctrine that deal with warmth diseases. These are spans from Song Dynasty to basically the Qing Dynasty. These are what we call contemporary doctrines. While the last 100 years, we are now in an integrative medicine doctrine. We consider that our modern doctrine. And if we can really understand Hejian doctrine, we need to also take the context of this time when this school of thought really developed. Hejian doctrine, Hejian is a name of a place which we'll discuss a little bit later, but this taken in place during the North Song Dynasty, which is around 960 to about 1127 AD. So much later, shall we say almost 700 to 800 years later than Zhang Zhongjin's book on Xianghanlun. A lot has happened during this period of time, and mostly a lot of wars, a lot of warlording, a lot of wars that really created a lot of famine, created a lot of starvation, and created a lot of disease. As much as the country is in chaos, this of course also in some ways stimulate different thought processes in how to treat diseases. North Song Dynasty is that one time where China is basically united for a very short period of time. Song Dynasty is a very unusual dynasty because a lot of things actually start to really develop in a great stride. For example, printing press. This is a time in the world that the first printing press and paper were developed in China. And this is a time the Chinese were able to actually develop the paper and start to create documentations through paper instead of in the old days where everything was basically written and carved on the bamboo shavings. As you know, with the bamboo shaving, bugs eat them. Bugs love bamboo. And so therefore, every few 20, 50 years, you have to re-carve these bamboo. So a lot of times mistakes are made, taxes are lost, things don't get passed down. So starting from the Song Dynasty onward, with the discovery and the creation of paper and printing press, a lot more Chinese medicine classics are now able to be preserved, edited, elaborated, and most importantly, passed down to the later generations as of today. And to look at the Song Dynasty, if you ever get a chance to look at a map, you'll see so North Song Dynasty. It's not a dynasty of great ease or great flourishing with no worries and no troubles. This is a period also China was facing immediate danger from the Mongolians, from the Diao North, Westia North, as well as the Northwest, the Mongolian tribes, as well as the Tibetan tribes from the West. So the Chinese were really facing tremendous amount of pressures from these tribes that is eyeing on China, and they can invade any time. And later on, the North Song Dynasty has fallen to the Mongolians, and a lot of Chinese moved to the south, especially south of the Yangtze River. So at that time, the Mongolian took over the Song Dynasty in some ways, and later on, as the Song Dynasty, as the Chinese moved down to the south, and that starts what we call the Southern Song Dynasty. And after the Southern Song Dynasty, that's when we have the Yuan Dynasty. That's where the Genghis Khan, Dubra Khan, they came to China and really took over the Chinese land and became the next emperor. In China, we call that the Yuan Dynasty. And during the Song Dynasty, there's also Mongolian Dynasty that is right above the Song Dynasty. We call that Jin Dynasty. So this whole period of time was there was a real struggle between the Mongolians and the Chinese, because the struggle, there was also a tremendous amount of conflict in how Chinese medicine advances and develops. And because of that, we have Jin Yuan, we call this Jin Yuan Dynasty, four major school of thought, or shall we call the four major physicians, which we'll talk about in a moment. So during this time, there is establishment of specialties such as pediatrics and gynecology. There's also establishment of special topics such as how to approach diseases in a different way. And if you look at He Jian, obviously, you know, China as a culture, still a lot of cultural influences is still along the Yellow River. He Jian is a location right in Hebei province and right just south of Beijing, the capital Beijing. So let's move away and just talk about the Jin Yuan four major physicians. The very first one is Liu Wansu, Dr. Liu Wansu. He is the initiator, establishes He Jian doctrine, which is what we are talking about today. The second physician is Zhang Chongzhen. He initiated Gongxie doctrine, sometimes is known as pathogen attacking doctrine, and frequently also called a detoxification doctrine. And then the third person is Li Dongyuan, or Li Gao. He is the initiator of Pi Wei Xue Pai, or we call the spleen stomach doctrine, and is sometimes we just call it the Earth School. And he is a part of the Yi Sui doctrine, the whole movement of Zhang Hu differentiation, how we can make Zhang Hu theory more robust. Then not at least, the fourth person is Zhu Zhenhen, sometimes known as Zhu Danxi, and he is the initiator of Danxi doctrine. And Danxi doctrine has a lot to do and really an elaboration on the whole concept that the world is of excessive yang and deficient in yin, and that disease treatment frequently means looking at fire, looking at a whole concept of ministerial fire, deficient fire, and how we treat this heat by nourishing yin. So we'll get into that in the future doctrines. So during this time, as we are looking at the He Jian doctrine, This is Song and Jin dynasties. This is a wartime, and Dr. Liu Wansu was born during this period of time. He was born around 1110 AD in the Hejian County of Hebei province. That's the reason why we also call this the Hejian Doctrine in northern China. The founding environment centered around the fire-heat pathology because during this time, the climates are very dry and the weather is very tough. And people takes, as they looking at their diet, and actually is still pretty much the same today, is that they eat a lot of beef, lamb, wheat, and alcohol. Now, since this is the four major food group of northern Chinese at that given time, I wonder if that have changed much today. Tough terrain, tough people, even with wind cold, frequently this transforms into heat or dryness. And this is also during this period of time, during the Song Dynasty, the government sanctioned the scholars and the physicians of this country to create a wonderful book called Taiping Huiming Heji Ju Huang, which is a Bible patent herb formulas. And it dwell on tonics, it dwell on a lot of warming herbs, and it doesn't really use quite well in heat conditions. And because of this, Liu Wansu decided to really explore the understanding of fire and heat pathology during this time. Now, in the Song Dynasty, because of these sanctioned formulas, people just can go to a herb store and just pick up a patent herbs. You know, if you have a cold, you can go pick it up a certain formula. So it's very quick. And there was less on the understanding of pathogenesis. So Dr. Liu Wansu, based on the foundation for Neijing, and he has spent 35 years to really perfecting his ideal of what fire heat theories and pathology is all about. So he really gave us 8 distinct contributions, or shall we say, features of this whole fire heat pathology. But out of this 8, there's also his own personal experience that he was able to contribute. So let's go through these ones. Number one, he really looked at how frequent fire heat invasion occurs. Okay. Number two, he also come up with the concept that all pathogens, all qi, all the 6 qi can all transform to fire. That's his concept. And number three, extreme emotions, extreme of 5 emotions can also create fire and heat pathology. So with that in mind, he was able to, number four, create therapies and herbal treatments for fire heat pathology. And number five, he continued to talk about the concept of yang qi stagnancy. Yang qi is supposed to be rising, supposed to be flowing smoothly, but there are times where yang qi can become stagnant. Number six, he talked about the wu yun liu qi bing ji. Wu yun liu qi is the cyclic transformation of weather pattern and climates. He talked about how these weather pattern changes can create pathology and diseases. So he elaborated further on that. And number seven, not the least, he talked about kang hai chen zi lun. He talked about in the 5 element principles and how the things that an element controls can actually come back and rebel against the controller. The mother that creates the sun, where the sun can come back and be rebellious and actually overtakes the mother element, for example. And number eight, he further elaborate on miscellaneous diseases. Again, don't forget, around that time, miscellaneous diseases still considered non-infectious diseases, like internal medicine, pediatric, OBGYN, those kind of issues and diseases and condition that's non-infectious. So let's go to the very first one, the frequency of fire-heat pathology. Originated from his really Neijing chapter 74 of Neijing Su, when it's on the topic of essentials of disease and therapies. And in this chapter, Neijing talk about the 19 etiologies, 19 etiologies that create diseases. So Liu Wansu, take a look at this, and if you look at a passage of this chapter, Huang Di inquires that, can you please describe the pathology for each organ system and its connection with the atmospheric influences? Qi Bo responded, his core physician responded, well, symptoms of tremors and shaking of the limbs, dizziness and vertigos are usually caused by wind and associated with liver. Many conditions of contraction and spasm are usually due to cold and associated with the kidneys. So he went on and on and on, talking about the 19 different etiologies. So to put it all together and put it in the chart, we would say all wind vertigo, it's a liver disease. All cold contractures, it's a kidney disease. All qi, asthma, congestion issue, it's a lung disease. All damp and swelling and fullness are spleen issues. All pain, itch, and rash are heart issues. Now, this is something we already know, and it's very rudimentary, very primary, very rudimentary. But don't forget, this is quite a while back. So the investment of a TCM is, though very still primitive at this time, but it's taken shape. It's becoming much and much more clear. So this, for example, is the five Zhang etiology. It also talks about the five cycles of etiology. So if we look carefully into the Su Wen 19 etiologies again, we will see that fainting and seizure, lockjaw and shivers, acute vomiting, manic and restlessness, edema and pain are due to fire. There goes five symptoms that's due to fire. Abdominal distension, swelling, borborygmus and tympani, vomiting of foul matter, acid regurgitation and acute dysentery with bloody stools, body torsion and turbid secretions are usually due to heat. There goes four more symptoms, conditions due to heat. So if you look carefully and you analyze all the 19 etiologies, which Dr. Liu Wansu asked us to do that, is that five of them belongs to Zhang conditions, Zhang organ conditions. Okay, one belong to wind, one belong to damp, one belong to cold, one belong to upper jiao, and one, you know, belong to the lower jiao condition. So he looked at this 19 and he eventually expanded that and expanded to 56 type of symptom conditions that's due to fire heat pathology. And he believed that occupies 80% of all etiology. So what he basically saying is that, you know, it's not wind cold that's creating the problem or disease. It's really 80% of it is all due to fire and heat. He believed we need to focus on this more. He is taking a total departure, you could say almost opposing to Dr. Zhang Zhongjin's Sanghan doctrine of injury by cold. So when he looked at 56 types of fire heat pathology, he said 56 type of symptoms and conditions are due to fire heat. And he pointed out asthma, vomiting, acid regurgitation, acute diarrhea, bloody, body torsion, spasms, turbid urination, that's basically UTIs, ascites with tympani, rash, hives, open sores, tumor, nodules, fainting, swelling, nasal congestions, nosebleed epistaxis, hematemesis, vomiting blood, bloody stools, fever, chills, shivers, fright, confusion, sadness, manic, restlessness, throat pain, ear ringing, hearing loss, blurry vision, sneezing, acute disorders, delirium, etc. He pointed out these 46 different symptoms and conditions are really due to fire heat. His second understanding is that all six qi can transform to fire. It doesn't matter if you were attacked by wind, damp, dryness, and cold. This can all transform to fire. Wind originates from he anyway. He is the source, and wind is the manifestation. Wind cannot exist without heat. You need that temperature difference. You need that heat for the air movement. So he believed very clearly that whenever you have wind, you're going to have heat, not cold. So in general pathology, wind, he believes, tends to combine with heat, not cold. Now this again, it's a total difference and departure from Sanghan. And also, it takes really a totally different understanding of what infectious disease talk about. That all infectious disease at the time of Wang Di Neijing was written was all Shanghan type. This is now a different type. This is a fire heat pathology. So for example, he talks about the treatment and the case of vertigo. He believed vertigo really started with a middle element weakness, or lung weakness. And when the middle element's weak, the middle cannot control the wood. As you know, the wood is the liver element. The wood become overabundant since it's out of control. When the wood is overabundant, its mother and son relationship calls for that the wood creates fire. And when you have wood creates the fire creates the movement. The wood gives you the wind, and the fire also creates the wind. This is where the wind and fire are both yang pathogens in nature, combined together and mutually feeding each other. As you know, if you ever live in Southern California, you understand that whenever we have a fire season, whenever there's a fire in the wilderness, the fire, as it becomes bigger, it takes on a life of its own. We call a firestorm. It creates a climate that the fire sustains itself because the wind and the fire just combines together, create an enormous amount of power. Well, this is no difference in what Liu Wansu is talking about, that these mutual combination of wind and heat grows itself even bigger, make this fire heat even stronger. So the yang energy like to move, therefore it creates movement in the body. And that movement is dizziness and vertigo. Dizziness and vertigo. Therefore, the treatment for vertigo is not just dealing with wind, but also the heat. When the temperature of heat goes down, the wind also goes down. The fire goes down. Okay. That's the reason why when you fight wildfires in Southern California, when the temperature drops, it's much easier to deal with the fire. So the treatment therefore must use pungent and cooling herbs. Pungent herb disperses the wind, cooling herbs cools down the heat. So, for example, this is his understanding of the vertical pathology and the type of treatment of herbs that he would use. Further onward, he talked about the relationship of damp and fire heat. that damp disease does not occur on its own. It is due to actually fire heat stagnancy, causing the body fluid to stagnate, creating water damp. So most clinical manifestation of damp is swelling. And most swelling is due to damp heat combination, creating sluggish urination. So he believed that this is not cold damp, it's more damp and heat, more the combination, not the other one. So the herb should be, again, pungent, but this time not cool, cold, because the heat is so strong, and it's bitter. So you need pungent, bitter, and cold herbs to get rid of the damp and get rid of fire and heat. Then he further onward talk about dryness, relationship dryness and fire heat. Well, as you and I know, dryness consumes influence and frequently transforms to fire heat pathology. When we have body fluid deficiency, blood can also become deficient, yin become deficient. All this can cause hyperactivity of yang, creating internal heat. Winter is cold and contracting and stagnant in nature. But the interesting thing is in winter, there is actually more dryness than summer month. So in this situation, he believed a lot of time we tend to try to warm up somebody in the winter, but he believed it's actually the opposite should be done. We need to nourish the yin and at the same time cools the dryness, cool the heat. So for treatment of dryness, that's what you should do, nourish yin and cool heat. Now let's talk about the relationship between cold and fire heat pathology. Now if we exclude yang deficiency, interior cold condition, which is what he called the true cold condition, there are two possible scenarios how cold pathogen really can transform to heat. One, when the wind cold invades, it comes into our body. As you know, cold is contracting in nature. It's like a tarp. So when that happens, and this is where he talked about his next theory, yang qi stagnancy. Yang qi is supposed to be moving all the time. So with the wind cold invasion, the yang energy gets stuck in the body. And this stuck of yang qi causes no dispersion. You cannot push the wind cold out. And when the yang qi is so stagnant in there, as you know, yang qi is heat in nature, it just creates more heat. Okay? So regardless the wind cold invasion, this heat need to also be dispersed. Okay? Second is extreme of cold. Well, you and I have learned that when it's the opposite, it can turn to the other side. So when there's an extreme of cold, it can transform to heat. So that's his second concept of the cold pathogen can become a fire heat. So one is the whole concept of the yang qi being stagnant. Second is the extreme that transformed to the opposite. So he goes onward and really elaborate and discuss about the extreme of the five emotions can create heat. Now, Liu Wansu is recognized with his work in exogenous fire heat discussions. But he also did some remarkable work in understandings of internal heat through the extreme of five elements creating heat. He believes that when we have emotional imbalances, doesn't matter which one, all the five emotions, when we have this imbalance, the yang qi gets stuck in our body. And this is where it can cause heat retention. And this heat retention can further cause the five emotional imbalances. It's almost like this wind and heat kind of feeding each other again. Emotional imbalance creates more emotional imbalance because this wind-heat situation. So he says anger causes qi stasis, which the stasis creates fire. Over excitation, feeds the heart fire. Over-worrying also again causes qi stasis, and the stasis creates fire. The sadness, when we have too much sadness, our qi gets stuck, and that stuck can also create fire. Fear, when we have too much fear, the kidney system, the water system, weakens. And so therefore, heart fire becomes rampant and is out of control. Fright then can cause heart movement, and the movement creates fire. So he talked about how all these elements, all these emotional elements can create heat. So when he talked about treatment of fire heat pathology, he talked about that you need to differentiate between what is exterior and what is interior. If you have an exterior condition, you treat it in a different way than the interior condition. For example, in the Biao condition, where it's the exterior condition, we should use pungent cooling or sweet cold herbs. Things like Ma Huang and Gui Zi are not suitable. As you can see, this is totally opposite from Shanghan Lun now. He frequently uses Gan Cao licorice, Hua Si, talcum, talc. He used Cang Bai, you know, the white part of the Cong Bai, the white part of the green onion, and Dou Ci, fermented soybean, for example. By the way, these four herbs became part of the repertoire later on for the Wenbin understanding, and a lot of time you'll see a lot of Wenbin masters use on these herbs. He also talked about formulas to use for treat of exterior condition. So he used this Biao Zhen, we call the exterior condition, with internal He Nei Ru. He suggests that we should use Fang Feng Tong Sen San. We should use Suan Jie San, both. Or use Tian Sui San plus Liang Ge San. Okay? And that's what he talked about. So we'll go through some of this. For example, Fang Feng Tong Sen San. It's a formula that uses to disperse Biao condition, but it also purges interior heat. Okay? So it does both very nicely. Take care of the exogenous, also take care of the endogenous heat. This formula is made of Fang Feng, Chuan Xiong, Dang Gui, Sao Yao, Da Huang Man Xiao, this purges the interior heat. Lian Qiao, Bo He, disperses the heat. Ma Huang, Si Gao, Ma Huang, as you know, is warming, but Si Gao paired together neutralizes it. Jie Gen, Huang Qing, Bai Zhu, Ji Zi, Jin Jie, Hua Si, Gan Cao and Shen Jiang. So this formula, when used combined, is to use to disperse wind, relieve Biao, clears heat, and purges heat. The next formula is Suan Jie San. Suan Jie San is a combination of Tian Sui San and Fang Feng Tong Shen San. It's used for measles. Around that time, there's quite a bit of measles, and it clears excess of the exterior and interior heat. Tian Sui San, sometimes we call it Liu Yi San. Liu Yi San or Yu Yuan San or Tai Bai San. Basically, it's a combination of six portions of Hua Si Talc and one portion of baked licorice and with some honey to make into the pill. This is used for summer damp heat, with fever, restlessness, thirst, sluggish urination with pain. So UTI is used in UTI and Sanqiao Tian He. So this is a very effective formula, actually. It's been used widely. It's still used widely today, especially when there is urinary bladder infection in the summertime. Liang Ge San is what we call the cooling the diaphragm formula. This is made of Lian Qiao, Da Huang, Mang Xiao, Ji Zi, Huang Qing, Bo He, Gan Cao. You could say that this is similar to Fang Feng Tong Si Shang, but it's much more abbreviated. Fang Feng Tong Si is this big, humongous formula, and this is much more abbreviated. Select some of the herb that really cools and gets rid of exogenous heat and also interior heat at the same time. You need to cook this formula with Zhu Ye and mix with honey. It's used to clear upper and middle jaw heat. It's good for heart fire. restlessness, thirst, red eyes, vertigo, dry mouth, canker sores, cracked lips, hematemesis, vomiting blood, epistaxis, nasal blood, nasal bleeding, constipation, sluggish urination, and infantile seizure. So this is for the Biao condition, exterior condition meaning. Now he talked about interior condition, Li Zhen. Now we need to purge more the interior heat. There are three scenarios. The first scenario is that the exterior condition is gone, and now we only have interior heat within and cause abdominal distension, restlessness, and pulses deep at axis. Second scenario is that there's deep heat that created a toxic situation, creating dry throat, asthma, abdominal pain, and pulses deep and threading. The third is a damp heat situation. So he basically take some of the work from Zhang Zhongjing, and he believe what Zhang Zhongjing had written, especially in the Yangming stage disease, formula was very useful here. So he brought in Da Chen Qi Tang. He recommended using Da Chen Qi Tang or San Yi Chen Qi Tang for this condition. He also devised and talked about Huan Nian Jie Du Tang, Huan Nian Jie Du San, and how this could be very useful. And now that these, a small dose of Huan Nian Jie Du San or Liang Ge San or a combination can be useful for this interior condition. So, moving onward to formula Da Chen Qi Tang, as you have studied in Shanghan discussion, is a combination of four major herbs: Da Huang, Hou Pu, Zi Shi, and Mang Xiao. It's used for constipation, fever, wiry pulse, delirium, asthma, Shanghan condition of constipation for 5 to 6 days. It's used in acute appendicitis these days. In the modern world, we use for acute intestinal obstructions and acute cholecystitis situation as well. Now, San Yi Chen Qi Tang is basically adding Gan Cao and Shen Jiang into the mix. So we have Da Huang, Hou Pu, Zi Shi, Man Xiao, Gan Cao and Shen Jiang. Now, when you have San Yi Chen Qi Tang, it's used mainly for both Biao and Li fire heat pathology, according to Dr. Liu Wansu. Another Li is Huan Nian Jie Du Tang. It's a combination of the three yellow plus the gardenia. So you have the Huang Nian, the cuptus, you have the Huang Bo, philodendron, you have the Huang Qin, scularia, and then now that these, you have Ji Zi, basically your gardenia fruit. The action is to clear heat, relieve toxin, and reduce swelling. And so it's used to treat all fire heat pathology, both Biao and Li fire heat, manic restlessness, dry throat, dry mouth, dry heaves, insomnia, vomiting blood, and nasal bleed. And as you know, Huan Nian Jie Du Tang has now become a very famous formula for almost all types of infection and inflammation that's pure heat oriented, pure heat oriented. Even to this day, it's been a very useful and very powerful formula. The fifth, let's go on moving forward, the fifth contribution he has was about yang qi stagnancy. So Liu Wansu, Dr. Liu Wansu's focus is not only on fire heat pathology, but also the patency flow of qi. He believes that the qi, like the universe, if you look at the universe, there is nothing in the universe that is in stillness. Nothing. Everything in the universe is moving. And for our body to be normal, everything in our body is and must be moving. So the patency flow of qi is very important. If our body's qi does not flow anymore or is stagnant, eventually it can cause death. And he says this in his book. He says, the great Tao or the great way has no shape or form. Without qi, no life can exist. Transformation of qi gives birth of all lives. Changes of qi creates changes in lives. Abundance of qi strengthens the organism. Deficiency of qi weakens the organism. The normal qi promotes harmonious lives. Deranged qi creates diseases. Termination of qi causes death of life. It's a wonderful, wonderful description on qi and the understanding of qi that even to this date, a lot of TCM students still recite it, still trying to understand the deeper meaning of this qi, understanding the mechanism of qi and how it affects life and death. So in his understanding of yang qi stagnancy is this, is that if the yang qi is stagnant, if it stops moving or doesn't move as much anymore, the fire heat develops. Fire heat develops. It's like creating a friction, and that friction creates heat and create many different pathologies. Okay, so this yang qi stagnancy is the basis for many, many different conditions. And there are two definitions to this. One, there is an imbalance of liu qi and wu qi. Okay, wu yun liu qi. Basically, what he's saying is this. There is an imbalance in the climate energy. So let's say the climate in the summer, we're supposed to be pretty warm and hot. But all of a sudden, we have a cold climate, which our body, our pores are open. We are so used to the hot summer now. And all of a sudden, this cold invasion, boom, it attacks our body, traps the yang qi. Yang qi doesn't move anymore. So this creates yang qi stagnancy. Or that is an actual attack of heat from the outside. So it doesn't matter, you're in the summertime, but all of a sudden, your 85 degree weather of summer went to 110 degree. Excessive, too strong, your body couldn't handle it. So that actual strong yang and heat energy actually attacks the body and traps and creates yang qi stagnancy. So with this yang qi stagnancy, it can create fire heat formation and is the basis of all pathologies. Now, today, how do we understand this yang qi stagnancy? Well, there's one thing that we actually understand and explains about stress. You know how stress creates diseases. And we don't always understand how does stress create diseases in the modern world, in the modern medicine. Well, TCN has a very good explanation why stress creates disease. Is this whole concept of yang qi stagnancy. When you have stress, when it hits your body, it's like there's a climatic change. It's a sudden thing. All of a sudden, your body doesn't know how to deal with it. It gets stuck. Your mind gets stuck. Your body gets stuck. The yang qi becomes stagnant. With this yang qi stagnancy, it creates fire heat formation and also becomes a foundation of all pathologies. So the treatment of yang qi stagnancy is really of three ways. Xuan, qin, tong. Disperse, cleanse, and opening. These are the three methodologies. To disperse, we use pungent. To cleanse, we use bitter. To open, we use cooling or cold herbs. So, xuan means to clear the biao. Not sweating, to clear the biao. To clear stagnancy, so use the pungent and cooling herbs. Qin is to cleanse. To cleanse the stagnant heat, use bitter and cold herbs. Tong means to open. Mainly, he means to purge. So use pungent, bitter, and cold herbs. Okay, this is his methodology of treatment of the yang qi stagnancy. So that's his fifth contribution to the fire heat pathology. Number six, He talked about the five cycles, six qi pathology. We commonly call the 五运六气, 病急学说. Even though human beings can master the environments, we can create and bring clothes when it's cold. We can bring air conditioning when it's hot. We can create a microclimate for ourselves. But climate, weather, and environmental changes are still very influential even today in causing or triggering diseases and imbalances, including formations of viruses, including formation of epidemics. So it still exists today. So these understanding of the cycles, the climatic cycle, the five cycles, what we call the five elemental cycles of the season, and how it affects the five zhang organs in our body, are crucial. So he believed a thorough understanding of it, it's a must. So for example, he looked at the five elemental principles outside of our body and inside of our body. If there is a situation where there's overabundance of earth, it can overact on the water element. And the water element therefore cannot control fire anymore. This will create fire pathology and start to create stomach ache, acid regurgitation, abdominal distension, and rash and itchiness. Okay. So when we talk about abundance of earth, you know, we're talking about abundance of day summer. We talk about damp condition. We're talking about, you know, a weather that is very moist, very humid. So if you have this humid climate, it can create this whole cascade of events and give us more stomach ache troubles, more acid regurgitation trouble, abdominal distension and rash and itch conditions. He is very right. We see this a lot in the humid weather. So when the humid weather comes, that's where we need to look at. We need to predict, oh my God, you know, patient's going to come in with these kind of symptoms more. We need to be prepared to treat them. How about overabundance of fire? Well, when you have too much fire, you can overact on metal element. And when the metal element's been overacted upon, it's getting weaker. So you cannot control the wood element. When you cannot control the wood element, it creates wind pathology. And wind pathology creates vertigo and spasms. So when there's an abundance of fire, the excessive temperature of fire, the summer heat, you can get heat strokes. That's when you're going to start to get vertigo and spasm issues. So he is very clear about those kind of issues. And it's still some of his understanding is still quite helpful today. Okay. How about overabundance of wood? Springtime. Too much wind situation. You know, that can overact on earth. And the earth cannot control water because of it. And that creates kind of core pathology. And interesting enough, there's excessive wind, or shall we say, kind of allergies in the springtime. We're going to get diarrhea. We're going to get cold extremities, where that we have an aversion to wind and aversion to cold. Okay. What happens when you have overabundance of water? Okay. That's winter time. When the winter is too severe, it's going to overact on fire element. And the fire cannot control metal because of it. And when that situation occurs, dryness pathology occurs. We are going to have cough. We're going to have dry skin. We're going to have dry mouth. We're going to have dry throat. Kidney situation. And these occurs a lot in severe winter. Okay? Overabundance of metal. In that situation, it overacts on wood. Wood cannot control earth. And this is where we can create damp pathology because earth is not controlled. And that damp pathology can create swelling, borborygmus, and lethargy. For example, in the fall, in the autumn time, for example. So he discussed a lot of these climatic, not just changes, climatic, unusual climatic abnormality, and how that affects our body and create different sets of diseases. That's pretty brilliant, and that's very helpful when we are treating, and especially in places where we live, that there is really four distinct seasons. And especially right now with climate change, there's a lot of abrupt seasonal changes. Therefore, it's very helpful to use some of these theory today. Number seven, contribution. He talked about basically Kang Hai, Chen Zi discussion. Okay. He talked about how the climate changes and how the different pathology inter-support and inter-control itself. And the whole concept of rebellion, the whole concept of overacting, is somewhat not always a necessarily a bad thing. It's actually to ensure seeking for balance in constant imbalance state. He basically saying that it doesn't matter where you are, we don't have always regular seasons. There's always going to have some imbalance. The climate always going to create, always going to fight for some imbalance. So as human beings, so as everything we do in our life, there's going to be some imbalance, and that is normal. That is normal. Our body's whole role is to trying to find a balance within this constant imbalance. So that's the seventh contribution of that, you know, the mother and son relationship. The mother doesn't always have to be the one creating the son. The son needs to be rebellious. That rebellion of the son creates a better mother. Okay? So in some ways, that the five elements of controlling cycle, it's changed a little bit under his discussion. Okay? So then he talked about, and I'm not going to get into it too much. This is all another topic on the climate changes. He really takes a long time. He takes a lot of time looking into the energetics of these climate changes, such as the fire energy, the dryness energy, the cold energy, the wind energy, the heat energy, the damp energy, and how that affects the body in some ways. If you look at the slides, you'll see some of the slides that give you a little table. You can see how it affects and influences different channels. Let's go to his eighth contribution. He further elaborated on miscellaneous diseases. He has a wonderful book that he passed down to us. And I really highly recommend when you get a chance, do read it. And that book is called Huang Di Su Wen Xuan Ming Lun Huang. It's published in 1172 AD. 15 chapters. He collected 348 formulas. And some of the very famous formula he has used, such as Fang Feng Tong Sen San, Di Fang Yin Zi, Gui Ling Gan Nu Yin. And if you look at carefully, 66% of combination and warming and cooling herbs. So you can see, obviously, it's not everything is all cooling. It's actually quite balanced. In fact, you could say 21% is warming herbs and 13% of cooling. You say, wow. So he really talk about fire heat pathology, but he doesn't use as much cooling herb. But what you are missing is that he uses a lot of dispersing herbs. You see, the dispersing pungent and cooling herb, the dispersion is one of his trademark of how he treat diseases. So let's move on forward to talk about Di Huang Yin Zi. This is a wonderful formula he passed down to us and is used tremendously today in anxiety, in gynecological condition, and in infertility conditions. This formula is a big one, combined with Sen Di, Ba Ji Tian, San Zhu Yu, Rou Chong Nong, Si Hu, Fu Zi, Hu Ling, Si Chang Pu, Yuan Zi Gui Zi, Zao Ren, Wu Wei Zi, Sen Jiang, Da Zao, Bo He. It's about 15 herbs. And it's used to tonify kidney, benefit essence, nourish heart, and open orifices. For somebody who written so much about Biao condition, getting rid of heat, for him to come up with a formula like this, it's wonderful. He's coming up with a formula that cools, that actually takes care of interior deficiency conditions. So this formula today has been known to be used in stroke condition, loss of speech, especially in kidney yin and kidney yang deficiency types. It's used in locomotor ataxia. It has been known to be used for syphilis, spinal cord injuries or degenerations, sensory neuron issues, stabbing pains in the trunk, incontinence and impotence situations, okay? Meniere syndromes, hyperthyroid, neurasthenia, chronic nephritis, and not at least infertility conditions. Another formula he uses is Guilin Ganluyin, which is a combination of Liu Yi San plus Wu Lin San plus Han Sui Si and Si Gao. Liu Yi San, you already know, is a Hua Si and Si Gao combination, Hua Si and Gan Cao combination. And then you have Wu Lin San, as you know, that's Gui Zi, Fu Ling, Zhe Xie, Zhu Ling, Bai Zhu, these five herbs for water, metabolism and movement, diuretics. And you add Han Sui Si and Si Gao into the mix. And this formula is really useful in getting rid of damp, getting rid of swelling, getting rid of heat situation. So, He Jian Xue Pai, this fire heat pathology doctrine, really established a foundation for later on the pathogen attacking, or we call it detoxification doctrine, also the Dangxi doctrine, and not at least the whole understanding of warmth, Wenbin diseases. It talk about fever. It talk about how fever is an adaptive mechanism, and a lot of these formulas are used for fever. As you know, fever is a body's reaction to pathogen. Okay, so by using some of the pungent, cooling, bitter herbs, it helps the body to deal with the core body temperature, because fever is the raise of a core body temperature to a level which kind of kill the pathogen. And so what happens when a body gets into a feverish state is very damaging if it stays there for too long. So the dispersing, the cooling, the pungent cooling herb really helps to bring that down, for example. Infection. Okay, this is like the beginning of understanding of treatment of infection. As you know, infection is a detrimental colonization of host organism. It could be a foreign species, it could be a bacteria, could be a virus. And in some ways, infection is in a war, which is a war that's infecting the body, the organism, trying to utilize my resources, my body's resource, in order to multiply at the expense of me, the host. So therefore, having some of these treatment of the herb that can get rid of infection, and we see this a lot in the fire heat pathology, how some of the formulas such as Huan Yin Jie Du San is very useful in infection states. Inflammation. Well, interesting thing, our body actually creates inflammation. It's our first response of the immune system, and that inflammation is natural if it's temporary and if it's short-lived. It's a reaction to infection or irritation, and maybe referred to as what we call the innate cascade. So inflammation is characterized by what we call the quintets, the redness, the heat, the swelling, the pain, and dysfunctions of the organs involving. So if you look at these tenets, this quintet, you see this is actually in the fire heat pathology. Dr. Liu Wansu talked about very clearly. So if you want to understand how to treat inflammation, you have to study fire heat pathology. That gives you a very good foundation of understanding inflammation. And if you look at into the next slide, you'll see I have listed a whole bunch of diseases that are infection and inflammation that very much has been used and treated successfully, some of them, especially with fire heat principles and pathology. Some of these diseases, going from AIDS to chickenpox to yellow fever, West Niles, to even typhus fever, whooping cough, to parasitic condition. All this really comes into the umbrella of a fire heat pathology. So this doctrine has contributed to better understanding of infectious diseases, inflammations, and not at least miscellaneous diseases. So thank you very much for listening today, and I will see you next time.